الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين وبه نستعين وصلى الله على سيدنا محمد وعلى أهل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين
اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد.
السلام عليكم جميعا ورحمة الله وبركاته.
عليكم السلام.
We're reciting Surah An-Nisa, verses number أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم يا أهل الكتاب لا تغلوا في دينكم ولا تقولوا على الله إلا الحق إنما المسيح عيسى بن مريم رسول الله وكلمته ألقاها إلى مريم وروح منه فآمنوا بالله ورسله ولا تقولوا ثلاثة انتهوا خيرا لكم إنما الله إله واحد سبحانه أن يكون له ولد له ما في السماوات وما في الأرض وكفى بالله وكيلا لن يستنكف المسيح أن يكون عبدا لله ولا الملائكة المقربون ومن يستنكف عن عبادته ويستكبر فسيحشرهم إليه جميعا فأما الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات فيوفيهم أجورهم ويزيدهم من فضله وأما الذين استنكفوا واستكبروا فيعذبهم عذابا أليما ولا يجدون لهم من دون الله وليا ولا نصيرا يا أيها الناس قد جاءكم برهان من ربكم وأنزلنا إليكم نورا مبينا فأما الذين آمنوا بالله واعتصموا به فسيدخلهم في رحمة منه وفضل ويهديهم إليه صراطا مستقيما صدق الله العلي العظيم. Sometimes in society you find that there is one extremist ideology. So in response to that extremist ideology, sometimes you see another extremist ideology, right? For example, one of the extremist ways that was present in the West during the 17th, 18th, 19th century was the way in which they treated women. They did not treat them as human beings. They did not give them their rights. In fact, in some of the Western countries up until 1965 or 70, I believe, in the UK or one of the countries, a woman could not even have her own bank account without the name of her husband or her father. So in response to that extremist way of dealing with women, there was an extremist response known as feminism. And that feminism also became a very extremist feminism. That today you find, for example, there are women who, they are postmodern feminists who say that this modern feminism is way too extreme. Okay? So one thing it teaches us is whenever you have an extremist way of doing something, there's going to be an extreme reaction to it as well. For example, even in our own madhab, in our own religion, there are some people who have taken the status of the Prophet and taken it way too high. the status of Amir al-Mu'mineen of Imam al-Hussein, and they've taken the status to be a very, very high status, more than their status actually is. And there's a term for this in Arabic. This is known as ghulu, right? To do ghulu. For example, there may be some who may think that, you know, Imam Ali, na'udhu billah, is God, right? Or he has the status of a divinity. So there has been another extremist response to that as well within the Muslim community, that of Wahhabism, to say that no, the prophets of God, and for example the imams, or for example some of the awliya of the prophets of God, they're nothing but human beings. They're just postmen, right? Their job was to bring the message, and they brought the message. There's no importance to them. Sometimes you find an imam who recites salat in the masjid of the Holy Prophet in Medina, and he has been reciting salat over there for 40 years. He says that it is my honor and dignity that even though I have come and led salat, let's say 10 feet away or 20 feet away from the grave of the Holy Prophet, I have never gone and said salam to him. I've never gone and touched it. I've never gone and kissed it. I've never gone and looked at it. Right? So sometimes when you have one extreme, then its response is another extreme. Now, amongst the Ahlul Kitab, they also have an extremist ideology. According to the Qur'an, in the logic of the Qur'an, it's an extremist ideology. They considered Prophet Isa to be the son of God. Or they considered Prophet Isa to be God, right? However, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when He responds to that, He doesn't come and say that, no, Prophet Isa was nothing but a servant, he was nothing but a messenger, he has absolutely no importance. No, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, indeed, Prophet Isa was a great prophet. He has these qualities. In fact, let us tell you about who Prophet Isa is. But after all of these qualities, he is still a servant and a slave of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So now let us look at this verse of the Qur'an. Allah says, Ya Ahlul Kitab, O people of the book, La taghulu fi dinikum. Do not do ghulu, do not be extremist in your religion. وَلَا تَقُولُ عَلَى اللَّهِ إِلَّا الْحَقِّ. And do not say anything but the truth on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. إِنَّمَا الْمَسِيحُ. The Messiah, the Masih, Isa, was the son of Mary. He wasn't the son of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now, remember one thing. At that time, during the time of the Holy Prophet, in the common understanding of the Christians, in the common understanding of them at that time, they did consider Prophet Isa to be the son of God. They accepted him to be the son of God. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Isa is the son of Maryam. He is a Rasul of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There is no doubt about it. Wa kalimatuhu. He is the word of God. So what does that mean? A word is something that we create, right? Our words are our creation. Therefore, he is a creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He cannot be God. Secondly, a word. Words contain what is hidden in our hearts, right? You have a thought in your mind, you want to manifest it, you want to express it to somebody else. How do you do that? You do it with words. Prophets of God are manifestations of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Their attributes are the manifestations of the attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And therefore they are known as Kalimatullah as well. Al-Qaha ila Maryama wa ruhum min. You know, he sent it to Lady Maryam, and he is a spirit from God. So it's very important to understand this verse. But before we come to that, I remember once, some of you would remember, very few of you perhaps, we had a session on, our community had organized it, on Islam and Christian dialogue. And we had it at Richmond Public Library. And there was a small hall over there, we had organized it over there. And we had speakers from our community and speakers from the Christian community as well. And one of the persons attending over there was a brother from the Ahl Sunnah. Now the speaker from our community, I believe, had mentioned that Prophet Isa, we consider him to be Ruhullah. So this person said, because it's there in the ziyarat, right? As-salamu alayka ya waritha Isa, Ruhullah, for example, some of the ziyarat, alright? The Ruh of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this person objected and he said, where do you have this, that Prophet Isa is the Ruh, the spirit of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? So this is the verse of the Qur'an. وَرُوحٌ مِنْهُ. A spirit from him. Now it's very important to understand this. It doesn't mean that Prophet Isa is a part of God. or a part of the Godhead. Here it means the Prophet Isa, his spirit and him, they are the property of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. فَآمِنُ بِاللَّهِ وَرُسُلِهِ وَلَا تَقُولُ ثَلَاثًا. Do not say three, just say one. Even so today you will find, when you talk to Christians, especially to Christian priests, when I talk to Pastor Tim Kipfer, or if I take my students to go and visit Pastor Tim Kipfer, the first point that he'll make is, Muslims have a misconception. Christians are not polytheists. Christians are monotheists. We only believe in one God. We do not believe in three gods. We believe in Prophet Isa or Jesus, or we believe in Jesus to be, for example, a word of God. Or if we believe in him as the Son of God, not the biological Son of God, we believe that he had a special relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. All these points come out because the Quran took a strong view against that. In that day and age, and for centuries, the Quran took such a strong view and said, why do the common people amongst them believe in this? Why do they think of Prophet Isa as the Son of God? Why do they think of him as one of the personalities in the Godhead? Such a strong view over and over again that their priests had to come out and say, no, this is not our belief. We even don't prescribe to that either. Then the next verse, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala points out that Prophet Isa is a servant of God. In fact, he says, if you look at the life of Prophet Isa, he never said, I'm not a servant of God. There was a time when the 8th old Imam, Imam al-Ridha alayhi afdalu salati wa salam,
salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad,
he was debating with one of the Christians in the court of Ma'mun. So when he was debating with the Christian, he said to him that Jesus was not a good person. Something like that. He said, what do you mean? Got shocked. He said, what do you mean he's not a good person? You know, Jesus, Imam Al-Imamsay, did not used to pray. He did not used to worship God. He did not used to raise his hands in prayer to God. And this person said, you're absolutely wrong. In fact, I caught you now. You are wrong, and I know very easily I can prove that you're wrong, because we know Jesus used to pray. We know he used to worship God. We know he used to make his prayers to God. And he went on proving it, maybe from the Quran, from the Bible. He went through all of that. The Imam said, if you believe that he is God, then who's he praying to? And it demonstrates that he is a slave and a servant of God. Alright? So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, لَنْ يَسْتَنْكِفَ الْمَصِيحُ أَنْ يَكُونَ عَبْدًا لِلَّهِ. Prophet Isa never denied the fact that he is a slave of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now comes a very general principle in the Quran. God says, whoever rejects that he is a slave of God, does not consider himself to be a slave of God, he should remember one thing, he's returning back to me. So, let's go back into Arabia, 7th century. They had the concept of slavery back then, correct? Now think about how slavery worked at that time. If a slave worked for his master, would his master pay him? No. A slave doesn't get paid. If he does his work, that is what he was supposed to do. If he doesn't do his work, does he get punished? Yes, he gets punished. Okay. Does a slave have the right to run away from his master? Doesn't have the right to run away. If a slave did run away from his master back then, sometimes he escaped from his master and the master never got a hold of him, right? He ran away into a land far away until he died. Or sometimes the master got a hold of him. Now people in that time have these ideas. So the first question they ask is, well, if a person is supposed to be a slave of God, can he run away from the kingdom of God? And God says no. Even if you deny being a slave of God in this world, on the day of judgment, you will all return back to me. There is no escaping from God. Then the next question comes up, well, if I'm a slave of God, and if I do something good, if I believe, if I perform good deeds, is God going to reward me? And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, yes, I'm going to reward you. So let's come to this verse of the Quran. فَأَمَّا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا. As for those who believe, وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ, and they perform good deeds. Look at the sequence of it. Yes, perform good deeds. But before you perform good deeds, have faith in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It is the condition for the acceptance of your good deeds. Iman comes first, and then عَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ. فَيُوَفِّيهِمْ أُجُورَهُمْ. One, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to pay them their wages. God is going to give them according to their efforts, وَيَزِيدُهُمْ مِنْ فَضْلِهِ. But then God has His fadl as well as His grace. Can you imagine on the Day of Judgment, if God rewarded us based on our effort, what would we deserve? If God rewarded us based on our sincerity, what would we deserve? Absolutely nothing. We know that ourselves, how insincere our actions are, how unfocused our actions are, how uncommitted sometimes we are. If God gave us according to our efforts, we'd probably not get anything. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has said, and He says, وَيَزِيدُهُمْ مِنْ فَضْلِهِ. God is going to add for them from His fadl. وَأَمَّا الَّذِينَ اسْتَنْكَفُوا وَاسْتَكْبَرُوا. As for those who chose not to be the slaves of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and they showed pride in this world, what is going to happen to them? Allah says, we will punish them with a painful punishment, and they shall not find anyone to help them on the Day of Judgment. This is interesting. First, let's look at it in the context of Christianity. So even if a person came on the Day of Judgment and said to God, okay, well, maybe I did not worship you as much, but I worship your prophet. Or for example, I looked up to your prophet. Or for example, I really celebrated and praised this person, Jesus, whom you sent as a prophet. God says, it will not count. You are expected to be a slave of God. You're expected to have faith in God. You're expected to worship God. And then all of your other deeds will make sense. Now, remember one principle I've shared with you always. These verses, even when they talk about Christians and Jews and the kuffar, they are also relevant to us. They also speak to us as well. They also speak to some things that we do in our own lives as well. So let me ask you, you must have seen this sometimes within our own community. Somebody says, or he has this idea, that as long as I do the azah of Imam al-Hussein, as long as I do tawassul to Imam al-Hussein, as long as I keep his memory alive, then I don't have to pray, right? Then I don't have to do my wajibat. Then I don't have to worry about halal and haram. Imam al-Hussein will take care of it for me on the Day of Judgment. So look at what God says over here. If a person chooses not to be a slave of God on the Day of Judgment, nobody is going to be allowed to help him. Right? He should not expect the shafa'ah of anybody on the Day of Judgment. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, O mankind, قَدْ جَاءَكُمْ بُرْهَانٌ مِّن رَبِّكُمْ. A proof has come to you from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَانْزَلْنَا إِلَيْكُمْ نُورًا مُبِينًا. And we have revealed to you a manifest light. So according to the commentators of the Quran, the proof refers to the Holy Prophet. And the light refers to? And the light refers to? What does the light refer to? Any guesses? Sorry? According to many of the commentators of the Quran, the nur refers to the Quran, right? And if you think about light, right? You don't need anything to see light, but you need light to see everything else, correct? Therefore, the verse is saying that if you have the Quran with you, then you can use the Quran to understand everything around you. Secondly, some of the commentators of the Quran and even the hadith that we have say that the Burhan refers to the Prophet of Allah and the Nur refers to Imam Ali alayhi afdal salati wa salam. Therefore, the last verse says, as for those who believe and they hold firmly to the Nur, they hold firmly to the Burhan, they hold firmly to the teachings of the Quran and the Ahlul Bayt, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will make them enter His mercy and increase for them from His grace and guide them to the right path. Sallallahu alaihi wa sallam.